Stimate telespectatoare, stimați telespectatori, sunt Rodica Baciu și vă invit să urmăriți o nouă ediție a emisiunii Pentru Noi Femeile. După cum vedeți, este o ediție specială, deoarece și decorul s-a schimbat datorită programului deosebit de încărcat a invitatului nostru, pe care îl veți cunoaște imediat. Am ales să ieșim din studio și să venim în această frumoasă grădină din orașul Oradea, unde l-am întâlnit pe Lee Grady, pastor, editor la Charisma Magazine și autor a 4 cărți, printre care una tradusă deja în limba română. Este vorba de cartea 10 minciuni pe care le cred bărbații. Lee Grady este căsătorit de 30 de ani cu Deborah și au împreună 4 fete. Mă bucur să fie alături de noi astăzi și să ne împărtășească din bogata sa experiență și am uitat să spun ce era cel mai important. Lee Grady este un apărător al drepturilor femeilor și călătorește de buni ani în peste 26 de țări, unde aduce un mesaj de mângâiere și vindecare interioară. God bless you, Mr. Grady, and welcome to Romania.
Thank you so much for having me on the show. It's really nice to be out here in this beautiful place.
It's an honor for us to find a time in your schedule for this show, and it's important because I know your experience and your vision. It's very important for us women. You comes to Romania the fourth time this year. In last 4 years you came yearly. And please tell us a little bit about the Romanian experience, how you decided to come first time, and
Well, I came actually to Hungary in 2009, and on that trip I met some people from Romania, and that ministry invited me here, and I just fell in love with Romania the first trip. And every year there was always more work to be done. I've done conferences for women, conferences for men. This year we did a retreat for men, and we're talking about some other things. So I know my work is not finished here in Romania.
Praise God that He convinced you that it's a lot of work in Romania, and
yes,
this news makes us happy. I want to know, when you come first time to Romania, what was your impression? What did you find here? How was the women, the people, the church, the society? Mm.
Well, I was so fascinated, of course, by the fact that the church lived through the communist time. And I really respect people who endured during persecution. So I love to talk to people who lived through that time. And I know that the Romanian church has been tested by persecution. But what I really found here was people with passion for Jesus. I believe God's hand is on Romania. I believe He wants to use Romania to touch all of Europe and other parts of the world. It's strategically located where you can be in a lot of places quickly. I believe God is going to use Romanian people to go all over the world with the gospel. So I see this as a very strategic place.
Thank you. How do you see the women's in Romania?
Well, I know that there has been a lot of abuse. Whenever we would do ministry in women's events, women were very broken, they were very hurt, maybe in their marriages, possibly even in their churches, through just life. Life has been difficult for them. And so there's a great deal of healing, but I also found that the women were not always eager to tell about the pain because maybe they felt embarrassed or they weren't used to being encouraged to be open about this pain. So I'm trying to help people to be willing to bring their pain out into the open.
The most important needs of the Romanian women are?
Well, I would say number one, healing from abuse, from oppression. You know, Romanian people in general have been oppressed in the past, but I think that the women especially have suffered through the past, through the communist times, but now I think there's a great need for teaching on marriage and family and how women should be treated, how Jesus treated women, how we should value the gifts of women. I feel that maybe because of some religious attitudes, women have really been told, you just have to stay down here. Mm-hmm. And so they have gifts inside of them. They want to be used by God, but they don't feel free to do that. And so I want to encourage that freedom wherever I go.
And I think you do this by teaching. Teaching men's, teaching women's in these events, smaller or larger, that you participate already.
Right. Through of course, I write books about these topics. And that the books can reach people that I would never see. But when I go to a country, I try to do events that will allow me to not only teach, but pray for people and also to speak to leaders, pastors, and other influential Christian leaders to help them to see women in the eyes of Jesus, how Jesus views women. This is very important.
You come the fourth year in Romania. Do you already see some changes, some things that goes better if you observe in some domains things like this?
Well, I do believe that women are recognizing that they have a bigger role to play than they were told. And so it's like women are waking up in Romania. Every time I come here, I find more women who have been empowered by the Holy Spirit. Meeting you this trip is a wonderful encouraging sign that there's a woman of God who's on television encouraging women. This is very important because maybe 10 years ago that wouldn't have even been possible, or we would have been shocked. It's becoming more common. So, and I know women who travel now in this country and speak, and that wouldn't have been possible maybe a few years ago. So I do see encouraging signs, but my dream is to see a movement of women here in Romania, women who know Jesus Christ, and they are empowered by the Holy Spirit to change this nation. Because Jesus empowered both men and women to use the gospel to make disciples and change the nation. It's not just men doing this. God created male and female, and He called us to work together. So I'm very encouraged to see women beginning to take their place.
So I understand that you think that it's the place and the time for more blessing, for more for more from the Lord.
Of course. The reason why my ministry is called the Mordecai Project is because Mordecai came alongside his cousin Esther. He saw the call of God on her life. He knew that God was going to use her to save the nation. And it was not his job to do that. He had to encourage her to do that. There are some things that women have to do. And Mordecai encouraged Esther to take her place. And so that's what I want to do with my life, is I want to come alongside, encourage women, equip them, teach them, but ultimately say, it's your role now, do what God has called you to do. And we know that Esther was told, your hour has come, this is your moment. And I believe that's true of the women in Romania. This is their moment, and I don't want them to miss that moment.
Thinking about the Mordecai Project, I think that it's only for abused women from different country. I didn't understood, but now I understand better that also you have the side to encourage people involved to do more
God things. Yes, and to step into leadership, because Esther was a leader. And there are many women in the Bible who are leaders. Sometimes we think, oh, God doesn't let women do that, but it's in the Bible. There are many women leaders, and God raises up women to be leaders. And so when I go to countries where women are abused, of course, the first thing I have to do is help to heal them. Sometimes they don't even have a voice at all. Sometimes they don't even have rights of any kind. But once they regain those rights, then we can also encourage them to step into their roles of leadership and influence. Just because I believe there's many Esthers around the world, and there are many Esthers in Romania who simply need to be encouraged to take that place.
And many people that has the life risk are ready to be killed from the darkness, and these ladies must be released to do what God will.
Exactly. There's some things that are not going to be accomplished until women take their place.
I know this vision, it's not only yours person. Behind you are a lot of people sustaining you with prayers first, and I think with many other things. I observe on your blog your notice and invitation to pray for this trip in Romania. Please tell a little bit about these people pushing you in front and helping you to help women, to help us.
Well, I think there's probably about 4,000 people who have committed to pray for me when I travel. And many of those people have heard me speak in different events. Many of them are women in the United States and in other countries who are very encouraged because they see how God is moving through this message. And they feel that they can be a part of this by praying for me. So I'm very grateful for the prayer support. Thankfully, I don't usually get sick. We didn't have any accidents or problems while we were here. But also, we know that the message is getting out and that people are being touched. And that's the most important thing. And some of those people have helped us. We do a lot of compassion work. We have a home for girls in India. We are building a domestic violence shelter in Colombia and in Guatemala. And we're even praying about possibly we will do a project here in Romania. We're waiting to hear the Lord's direction on that.
I want to ask more about the Romanian projects, but first, please tell us a little bit about the first important woman in your life. It's your wife, and also about your daughters, because everyone wants to know about your family.
Yes. Well, my wife, Deborah, we have been married for 30 years, as you said, and we started having children immediately after we married. And we just had one girl after another. Of course, she never planned that. We didn't know we would end up having a house full of women. But after I had three girls, I remember just thinking, we might as well just keep having girls, just keep it a matched set. And so I love to tell people that every time a girl was born, I always rejoiced. I was never disappointed that I didn't have a boy. And I remind women of that because in some countries, fathers always want boys.
Sometimes in our country, yeah. It's like this.
In fact, in Nigeria, I know a lady who, when she was born, her father called the whole village together and they mourned publicly that he had a daughter. Because in some cultures, girls are viewed as being inferior. But that's not what Scripture teaches. And I know that my Heavenly Father rejoices whenever a girl is born. So I received from God what He gave me. And then I began to realize this was God's purpose, because He wanted me to see how much He values His daughters. This is why He gave me girls. And so I raised those girls to believe that they could do anything, that gender is not a restriction for them. And now my girls are grown and they're discovering their way in life and finding their husbands and starting families. And they very much appreciate the foundation that I laid in their life about equality. But now I have the opportunity to take that message to a much bigger world.
How old are your daughters?
They're all in their 20s. They range from 28 to 22. And my oldest daughter is now, she has two children, two sons. So I now have grandsons.
Ah, you are also grandparents.
Yes, and my daughter, she adopted a baby from Ethiopia. And then they had their first biological child 1 year later. So I have a grandson. My first grandson is from Africa.
More about your wife. How you are together in ministry? Because you travel more alone or with some people like Timothy in the Bible, but not so much with Deborah.
Part of that is that when I first started traveling, we still had some of our girls were home, and we didn't want to leave them alone. So Deborah felt her first call was to stay home with our girls, which I think is important, and that's where she felt her primary ministry was. And I don't, you know, even though I'm a champion for women in ministry, I don't believe that women should neglect their families in order to do ministry. I don't believe anybody should neglect their family. I think family is important. And so she felt that she should stay home with them. Then when all the girls left the house, which was 2 years ago, people began to ask her, are you going to be traveling more now? And she has traveled with me more than ever, but she doesn't like to go as fast as I go. So probably this year she'll go on one more international trip, but she is very content to stay home and pray for me and welcome me home when I get back.
So it's
when she goes with me, she's very involved in praying for the women. She loves to do ministry, counseling, and she's got a very compassionate heart to pray for those who have been through these kinds of painful abuse. And so she has the same heart I do for this problem.
You mentioned that in Romanian are things to do, and we think you will come back next year. Will be very nice to come together with your wife, to can have a talk show together and to know more about your projects.
Well, I'll let her know that you want her to come on this show, and we'll see if she comes.
Because it's very important to know who's beside you,
yes,
who sustain you. We already hear from you, but to know personally, it's good. If you plan to come back in Romania next year, what kind of projects you have in mind? Or
well,
which kind of needs you want to fulfill?
Sure. I work on three different levels. I speak to women, oftentimes about the issue of abuse, sometimes also empowering them for leadership. I also speak to men, and that's what a lot of what I've been doing this trip, helping men to learn to love their wives in a Christ-like way, and also teaching men, helping men to be healed, because this is one reason why we have so much abuse, is that men are not healed, and they have anger. A lot of men struggle because of their relationship with their fathers. And so this last week we prayed for men in these areas. I'm very troubled by the way that fathers have treated their children here in Romania, and even their sons. So there's a lot of healing that needs to happen. And then also families. I like to speak to husbands and wives together, and I like to teach men how to treat their wives, because oftentimes the reason we have abuse in the culture is because we even have it in the church. And we even have men in the church who are abusive to their wives. And I know we have this problem here. So it has to be addressed. It has to be confronted. There are things that we don't typically talk about in church, but I think we need to. So it's important to talk about things like abuse, like pornography, like adultery, sexual addiction. These kinds of things have to be addressed if families are going to be saved. marriages are going to last.
Do you think things like this exist but are covered by a lot of religiosity or?
Of course, people can go to church and they can put on a nice clothes and pretend, and they can put on a religious mask. But what's really happening deep down in the heart, if we don't address these problems in church from the pulpit, then they're never going to be addressed. I believe that whatever we don't talk about from the pulpit is going to thrive in the darkness. And so I believe in being very honest. And I think that there's some things maybe that haven't been talked about in Romania up until this point. And I think it's time to have the conversation. One of those is about abuse. Another of those is about where women stand in the church and what is their role and what can they do. I think these are things we have to talk about.
Do you plan for the next year? I heard a new conference with people from different regions to have influence in different places with sharing this teaching.
Here in Romania?
Yes.
I think that would be wonderful. I would love to do a conference where we can get husbands and wives together, women who feel called to ministry, as well as women maybe who have experienced abuse that need healing. There's so much to address in the church along these lines. And so if we had a conference where husbands and wives could come together, that would be beautiful. And then also we can speak directly to the women sometime, we can speak to the men, and we can speak to them together.
And I think the idea to teach people, men and women, how to complete, not to compete each other in leadership, it's a very good one and necessary.
Exactly. And we have to speak that to the men to say, we're not empowering women so that they will overthrow you or do your job. We've got plenty of work to do, and we need the women to help us. Women being empowered for ministry is not going to, it's not going to be competition. We need to learn to work together, because Jesus set all of us free. He died on the cross so that men and women could be free. But we have many women who don't feel free.
Because the message sometimes, what I hear from women, it's sometimes men think if a woman do that things, take my job, if it's involved in leadership or make something in the church, what will do I? Like men.
And what I would say to that person is, look at Romania and what is the percentage of people who are born-again Christians? It's a very small percentage so far. We have so many people to reach with the gospel of Jesus Christ. So if a woman feels called to ministry, she's not going to be taking this person's job. There's a whole new group of people who need to be helped. So why wouldn't we want that to happen? Why wouldn't we want to reach more people for Jesus? That's why I am so passionate about empowering women, is because I care about the lost and I care about the harvest. And Jesus said, pray to the Lord of the harvest that he would raise up laborers and send them into the harvest. He didn't say just raise up men. He said raise up laborers. And he wants both men and women to go into the harvest.
But it's very interesting that a man to have the vision, to have the idea, I think it's from God, but it's interesting that, as you mentioned, are a lot of things to do, are a lot of people to touch with the gospel, and you choose to take care about the women's. maybe if you can share with us more explanation about your motivation, will help us.
Sure. Well, I don't see that as being strange at all, because I believe it was a motivation of Jesus. when Jesus was on earth, he spent a lot of time ministering to women. And that's, we read the gospel and we read the stories of how he healed the woman who was bleeding, or he defended the woman caught in adultery, or he healed the woman who was bent over in the synagogue. And we read all these stories and we don't realize how revolutionary that was in that culture. Because the religious people of that day did not even notice women. They didn't care about women. The Jewish leaders, the rabbis, they viewed women as being way down at the bottom of society. They wouldn't even speak to them publicly. If a woman was coming down the street, a rabbi would get on the other side of the street because they wanted to stay away from women. Jesus was radical in the way that he treated women. And he even allowed Mary of Bethany to sit at his feet and be in the posture of a disciple. That was radical. No Jewish rabbi ever did that. But Jesus had a completely different view. And then the most radical thing was, of course, he had women followers. We know their names. We read about them in Luke chapter 8. And then we know that when Jesus died on the cross, the women who followed him came to the tomb, and when Jesus appeared to Mary Magdalene, he said to her, "Go and tell my brothers that I'm alive." And so he gave Mary Magdalene, one of his women followers, the opportunity to be the first person to tell that Jesus was raised from the dead. To me, that shows the radical nature of Jesus, that he would do that, because in the time of Jesus, women were not even allowed to testify in a courtroom. They wouldn't trust a woman's testimony. But Jesus picked a woman to be the first one to testify of his resurrection. That tells me that he's intending to use women to preach the gospel.
And we can continue with examples Jesus speaking with the women outside the Samaria, mm-hmm. and she go back and tell to everyone
exactly
about the prophet.
When she went back to her village, she didn't just start a women's Bible study. The Bible says she preached to all the men of the village. And probably in that group of men were the men that she used to be married to. And yet she preached to all of them, and they all came and believed that Jesus was the Messiah. And the Bible says it was because of the word of the woman. So anybody who questions God using women to preach the gospel, I don't think they read their Bible. Because this is the core of the gospel. When Jesus puts his love in a person, he intends for them to share it. And when that woman, who was a very abused woman, she was an outcast in her society, the woman in Samaria, when she received the love of Christ, she couldn't be quiet. And how tragic that we try to quiet these people. If they experience God's love, we don't want them to say anything. And yet Jesus was empowering her to preach. And a whole village was changed because of her.
And also in the New Testament, after the Jesus' resurrection, we have some examples. I like Lydia, mm-hmm. being the first, I name her first European Christian, women of business women, mm-hmm. and I like her that she multiply and.
She was a strategic woman. God used her as a door to this region of the world. So how much more? We shouldn't be surprised that God would want to use women here in Romania, when really Lydia is like a spiritual mother to you and to any women in Europe. She's like a great example. And I think that shows us that God always has had his hand on wanting to use women in Europe. You know, that's very, very strategic. And throughout the book of Acts, you see women being used by God. On the day of Pentecost, we know that there was 120 people gathered there, and there were many women in that room. And when the Holy Spirit was poured on the people, it says everyone spoke in tongues, everyone had flames of fire on their head, and it was not a pink flame on the women and a blue flame on the men. It was the same Holy Spirit on everyone. Because Paul, the apostle, said, when we are in Christ, there is no black or white, male, female, slave or free. Those kinds of things don't restrict the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And so from that room, those people went out and they took the message of the gospel. And Peter stood up on the day of Pentecost and he announced that this was going to be true. He said, in the last days, I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh, and your sons and your daughters will prophesy. So he said right there, women are going to speak for God, they're going to preach, they're going to be used by the Holy Spirit in the last days. And here you have these women speaking in tongues right here. You might as well get used to this because things have changed. Pentecost changed everything. You used to have the old covenant restrictions in, you know, of only men could do this, only men could do that. But when the New Testament is inaugurated and the Holy Spirit comes, it's different because women are involved from the very beginning.
Starting with 94, you wrote 5 books till now. Mm. The topics are around women's rights, but not only. Who are your target readers for these books? Also women or not only?
Well, the book that I wrote called 10 Lies the Church Tells Women, that was primarily written for women, but I also wrote it for leaders because I believe that pastors, in a sense, they can open or close the door to women. And I believe that God wants pastors to open doors of opportunity for women instead of closing them. I see the Apostle Paul, for example, as somebody who opened doors for women. He had Priscilla, he had Phoebe, he had Yodia, Syntyche, Nympha, Chloe. There are many women mentioned in the New Testament who were on his team, and they were part of his leadership team. So Paul opened doors for women, but today we have a lot of pastors who shut the door. And so I wrote that book not only for the women who feel a call of God and they need to be equipped, but for pastors who maybe struggle. Should I train these women or not? Should I give them this opportunity or not? And they're wrestling with tradition, and yet they feel the freedom of the Holy Spirit, and they don't know how to reconcile these things. So that's why I wrote that book. I wrote another book, 10 Lies Men Believe, which was translated into Romanian, to help men get healed in their hearts and to help them to stop mistreating women. Because I don't believe we will stop the abuse of women until men are changed. And then I also have a book called The Holy Spirit Is Not For Sale, which was written to people who embrace the power of the Holy Spirit, and yet they want character and they want integrity in the moving of the Holy Spirit, because we know that sometimes we misuse the gifts of the Holy Spirit. So I'm very concerned about that as well.
So the men or women are invited to read your books. Sure. I want to give the information that two of them are translated in Romanian language. So the Holy Spirit is not for sale, and 10 lies that man believes. What's about the lies that church tell women? Do you plan to be translated?
We're hoping that it's possible, and if we do the conference next year, I'm going to try to push that we could have that book translated by then and published.
I already hear, not official, that the book already exists translated. She's waiting somewhere to be put on the paper.
It needs to be printed. Edited, but it's been translated, yes. Someone from Romania read the book when it first came out and they immediately translated it.
So the good things are very close from us. But with these titles, you didn't got problems because you use some difficult words, lie, church, women's. You had a lot of courage.
Well, yeah, people have said, well, does the church tell lies?
Yes.
And of course, Jesus doesn't tell lies. But sometimes people in the church have told lies. And sometimes the church has not represented the heart of Jesus. You know, I know some people have a hard time hearing that, but it's true that sometimes we misrepresent God's heart to the world. And so I really, I want the church to reflect the heart of Jesus. And I know that Jesus wants to heal women. I know that he wants to confront men about the way they treat women. And I also believe that God has a lot more for women to do than they are experiencing now. So that's why I wrote the book.
And so you see the situation with door closing for women are at the same level in whole the world, or in some countries it's better. I don't know how it's in United States. Mm-hmm. Did you compare Europe with United America? And
it's different in all parts of the world, but there is a tendency sometimes to misinterpret certain scriptures in the Bible and use those to restrict women. I learned when I went to China a few years ago that I found there were many, many women involved in ministry. And this was, of course, in an underground, persecuted environment. The church is not free to, you know, you can't preach on the streets. There's a lot of restrictions. But in China today, a large percentage of the church planters in China are women. And they are free to preach, to disciple believers, to pastor, to do many, many different things in ministry. And one of the reasons why I believe that's true is because things are happening so fast there. They're reaching 25,000 people for Jesus every day in China. So there's so much work to be done. And they need everyone to be working. And so God has empowered these women, and they're doing a wonderful job. They have incredible ministry, and yet they suffer because of persecution. But in the Chinese church, for the most part, you don't see these same restrictions that we experience in other parts of the world.
It's more persecution from outside of the church, and
yes,
not so much closing the opportunity for women.
What I have learned is that every time there is spiritual revival, whenever the Holy Spirit comes in power, and there are large numbers of people converted, and the Spirit of God is moving, then always women are liberated into more freedom. This has always been true in the past, whenever we've seen revivals in the past. When that spirit of revival dies down and more religion sets in, then the doors begin to close to women. And also the Holy Spirit's liberty also goes down.
Restricted.
So I think we need to pray for revival.
Yes, we already pray, but it's good to pray more and to step ahead, to do some actions. Let's explain some texts from the Bible that are very different understanding from people to people. Mm-hmm. For example, how do you understand the Corinthians chapter 11? He, you know, tell about the women's clothes in church, and some church are very restricted, some not.
Mm-hmm.
How you consider that it's the true with
sure.
this message?
Of course. I'm very aware that in some cultures, people use 1 Corinthians 11 to teach that women have to have something like a scarf on their mm-hmm. head. And I know that's true in some Slavic countries and in Romania. But of course, around the world, that's not viewed that way in other countries, because many people have come to believe that what Paul was dealing with in that passage was something cultural that was going on at that time, because they were asking for women to be covered so that there could be a distinction between male and female. And they viewed a woman without a covering as somehow she was not being a woman. But we don't have those cultural restrictions today. If I see a woman who's not wearing a head covering, I don't think that she's trying to be a man. That's not my culture anymore. So I don't believe that that physical piece of fabric is something that is required today for a woman who's praying or who's in some kind of ministry setting. I think that back then, if we were in that church and we knew the culture of Greece in the first century, we would understand better why there was an argument about that. But those cultural issues do not apply to us today.
So your meaning is that the most important things are the inner things, and this was a prescription for that time and that region?
Yes, and also there were people back in the days of Jesus who believed that when you came before God, you should cover your head because you were ashamed, because you were a sinner. And, you know, after Jesus died on the cross and he took our sin, he also took our shame. So when I come before God, I don't have to feel horrible about myself. I don't have to bend over and, you know, feel like I'm a terrible person, because I've been freed from guilt and shame, and I've been made righteous by the blood of Jesus. So I don't have to have this separation anymore between me and God. There were times back in the days of Jesus when even men would cover their heads to pray. This was being people were stopping that practice after Jesus came, but they were somehow saying that women should still do it. You see, and Paul, I believe Paul was actually saying that, you know, it's not necessary for anybody to have a covering over them when they come before God, because we have been covered by the blood of Jesus now, and we don't need any other kind of covering. So whether you're a man or a woman, it's not required for us to do that. I'm so thankful that the blood of Jesus covers me. And when I come before God now, I can have a relationship with Jesus Christ that's personal and real. And a woman can have the same thing. And there's no shame and there's no separation.
Here it's a lot of noise, a lot of discussions in some place. It's important or not important to have this scarf that was mentioned by Paul in Corinthians chapter 11. But how do you think that lose people concentrating to this opposite point of view? Insisting on and fighting each other in this way.
Yeah, it becomes a real distraction from the main goal and the main focus of our faith. You know, Jesus set us free so that we could share the gospel with the world, not so that we can sit around and argue about whether we're praying in the right way or have something on our heads or not. I don't see Jesus being concerned about that. I think he wants us to share his love with people. And also, it's interesting that in the passage in 1 Corinthians 11, and they're talking about a woman's head being covered, Paul says that the woman is praying and prophesying. And some of the people who insist on a woman being covered, they don't believe that she can preach or prophesy. But that's what that scripture says. It says the woman is prophesying.
Another topic, very hot, is if women can speak in the church or not. And this is, some people use the 1 Timothy 2, 11, 12 that tells women not tell the others. It's not allowed for the women.
In 1 Corinthians 14:34, which says women must be silent. Yes. Mm-hmm. It's interesting that somebody will take that verse and they'll pull that one verse out and then they will ignore many, many other verses in the Bible. Because I believe that the way that we interpret the Bible is that you must use the whole Bible. When you interpret one verse, you look at that verse in the light of the rest of Scripture. And so I look from Genesis to Revelation, and I think it's important that we read our Bibles. We know what is in the whole Bible, because this is the whole counsel of God. So you look through the Old Testament, and one of the things you will notice is that God uses women, and that He speaks through women. There are many women prophets, even in the Old Testament. Deborah, for example, who led Israel for 40 years. Miriam was a leader in
and
Israel.
And was a good leading in compare with a lot of kings that was not after
exactly.
the God will.
Esther, of course, we know God used her to speak on behalf of a nation. We know that there was a prophet named Huldah during the reign of Josiah. You see all of these different women in the Old Testament, and that was in the Old Testament when there were many restrictions. Then when we come to the New, and we see how Jesus freed women during His time on earth, then we see how the Holy Spirit empowers women in the book of Acts, and you begin to see these women leaders emerging. You see someone like Priscilla, for example, who traveled with the Apostle Paul. We know that she taught the Bible. She had a husband named Aquila, and they are shown in the book of Acts teaching. We know that Paul had a woman named Phoebe who was a deacon, and she was empowered by Paul to go to Rome and to take the letter of the Romans to them. And he told the Romans to basically to do what she said. He had a woman named Chloe who had a group of churches that he mentions her in the book of Corinthians. He mentions two women leaders named Euodia and Syntyche in the book of Philippians. And he says that these women were not getting along. They were leaders, but they were having some conflict. And he told his colleague, help these women in the cause of the gospel. So he had women who were involved in the work of ministry. And we also know that he told us, Paul told us that in Christ there's no male or female. And when he talks about the spiritual gifts in the book of 1 Corinthians and he names those gifts, he never says that these gifts are only for males. He says the Holy Spirit distributes spiritual gifts to whoever the Spirit desires. So spiritual gifts are given to anyone in the body of Christ, irrespective of gender or race or economic status. The Holy Spirit can give the gift of prophecy to a rich person. He can give the Holy Spirit to a person of another ethnic background. And He can certainly give a spiritual gift to a woman. And many, many women in Scripture had these different spiritual gifts. So that's how I view the Scripture. And then when I see a verse in 1 Corinthians 14 where Paul says, I want the women to be quiet and go home and talk to their husbands about what's being discussed in church, I know that he's not saying women can never speak in church, because he already has Priscilla teaching the Bible. And he's already told in that same letter in chapter 11 that the women were prophesying who had their heads covered. So we know that Paul had women on his team. When you see a scripture that seems to contradict the rest of the Bible, you have to dig deeper and find out what was going on. Most people, even the most conservative Christians, who don't necessarily embrace women preaching, they would say that Paul was telling the women to be quiet so that there would be peace in the meeting, because there was a lot of shouting going on and that he was bringing order.
Not so good communication rules.
Exactly. So however you want to look at that scripture, I cannot in any way believe that Paul was saying that he was telling women not to teach, because he already had women doing that. And we already have a heritage, even in the Old Testament, of women doing that. When you look at the book of Proverbs, for example, wisdom is personified or symbolized in the book of Proverbs in chapter 8 as a woman preaching in the streets. If God doesn't believe in women preachers, why would he describe wisdom as a woman preacher? And say, I know many women preachers around the world, and I know that those women that I am so proud of, they are women of great wisdom, great influence, and they get up and they announce the gospel, and people come to know Jesus through what they speak. And so they're not doing anything other than obeying the Great Commission. I certainly don't want to punish a woman for obeying God. So a woman who feels called to speak for God, we should allow her to do that. This is what she was created to do. I also know from, because I raised four girls, I know that girls talk. In fact, I learned that girls learn to talk sooner than boys, because my girls were very verbal. And then when we would have parties, for birthday parties, and the little boys would come and they were the same age, I would compare them and I would think, these boys don't talk as much as these girls. Why would God create women to talk if he was going to tell them, you can't talk for me? That's not a good God. God is a good God. He's a good father. And he loves his girls. And he created his girls to talk for him. And I believe we should give them that freedom.
Another point that it's with a lot of discussion around, it's equality, it's women inferior or not. How do you think about this point?
Well, in no way do I believe that God views women as inferior, because he created both male and female in Genesis chapter 1, and he gave them the same commission. He told male and female, go and rule over the earth and populate the earth. So he spoke that to both. He gave them the same commission. Also, when God spoke to Adam in Genesis 2, and he said, it's not good for a man to be alone. I will create a helper for him. The word helper in the Hebrew is ezer, the word ezer. And it's actually the same word that is used for God many times in the Old Testament, because we know God is our helper. We would never think that God is inferior to us when we say that he's our helper. But a lot of times when men read that verse, oh, my wife is my helper, they think, well, she's down here, she's going to do my laundry, she's going to be my cook, she's going to have kids. They look at that as being something inferior. But that is not what that verse implies. A true helper, if it's the same word used for God, then certainly she can be viewed as an equal. And when Adam received Eve as his wife, he began to say, she is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. He recognized that she was made from the same substance he was. And he recognized her as his equal. In the past, say like in ancient times, in Greek culture, for example, they actually believed that man was created from God and that women were created from animals. This is how a pagan viewed women. But that is not a Christian view. A Christian view is that the male and the female are made also from divine matter, that we are both in the image of God, and that together, male and female together, reflect the image of God. So when we have that view, it eliminates a lot of problems in marriage and in society when you decide that because of God's love, we're going to treat women as equals with men, which means they should have the same opportunities. We should give them the same education. We should give them the same protection as men. And yet in so many countries where I go, girls are not even allowed to go to school. They're told, well, you should just stay home and learn how to cook because that's all you can do. And yet that's why these nations are in poverty today, because they never allowed girls an education.
I think these misunderstandings with a lot of effects has a source. Do you think about this source?
I believe the source is what we see in Genesis chapter 3, that when sin entered into the world, it ruined the world. Sin brought in sickness, it brought in death, it brought a curse on the environment, and it created all kinds of dysfunction in male-female relationships. And in Genesis 3, verse 16, God speaks to the woman and he says, your husband will rule over you. Now, I don't believe God was saying that that was his will for men to be harsh or dominating or abusive. But what he was saying was, in a fallen world, in a world without Christ, in a world without redemption, in a world where people reject God, there's going to be this horrible abuse, because the more dominant, the stronger is going to dominate the weaker. And so this has been the history of the world. But when Jesus came, he came to set us free from that. And when Jesus comes into a man's heart, he frees him from that tendency to abuse, and then that woman can be loved and cherished as a daughter of God and as an equal, and they can experience restoration in their relationship. I don't believe that marriage really works without Christ, but because Jesus has come, that restoration is possible, and then women don't have to suffer like that. And so wherever Christianity goes in the world, usually women's situation improves, and they begin to be healed, and there's an elevation of women in society. This has been true around the world. And that's why I'm doing what I do, because I believe the more we take the gospel, in fact, I tell people, Genesis 3:16, which represents pain, it has, that verse, that Genesis 3:16, has been canceled by John 3:16, which is the coming of Christ and the fact that he paid for our sins. When we fully embrace all that Jesus did for us on the cross, part of that redemption is the healing and the elevation of women.
Who's your favorite Bible personage?
Well, I guess I would have to say Mordecai, because I named the ministry after him, because I see him as someone who was a champion for women. He was a very godly man who cared about the people who were dying. He was worried about the fact that a whole nation was about to be killed, and yet he recognized the call of God on Esther. So I've always identified with him, and that's why I named my ministry after him. And God blessed him as well, so, and gave him the resources and the influence to be able to bring change to a nation. And I pray that I will be able to do the same.
With this man, Mordecai, you come back to the Mordecai Project. Tell us a little bit about what it's doing, your ministry in country like Nigeria, Guatemala, India.
Mm-hmm. Our dream is to set up a network of projects that will be helping women and girls who suffer from gender-based violence. So I've identified 17 places in the world so far where I have relationships, either with a church or with a ministry. And we are going to partner with them. I'm going to raise the needed funds to launch the project. And we will be either doing homes for girls. In some contexts, that's what we need to do, like India. Because in India, girls are abandoned by their parents simply because they're female. Two of the girls in our home in India were found in trash cans when they were infants. So parents literally throw girls away. And I believe that Jesus wants to save those girls. And so we have them in a home, protected. We're providing education for them. And we'd like to do many more homes like that in India. In Latin America, the biggest problem is domestic violence. And we have women who actually are killed by their husbands in those countries. So we need to provide places where women can go when they are threatened or when they're living with in violent situations that are very unsafe. They need to be able to get out of those homes and find a safe Christian environment where they can be healed, get counseling and protection until they can find a better place for them to raise their families. And then here in Romania, we're still praying. You know, we're very aware of the problem with sex trafficking here. We know that there are women who are literally held as slaves. And so we're not sure whether we should create something that would help them. We also know there is domestic violence here in Romania, and perhaps there's the need for a shelter here. So we're still prayerful about that. But in so many of these countries, in Africa, we have a need for shelters, but also to give the women some training so that they can learn some skills and be able to provide for their families, because many women who have children have been abandoned by their husbands, and their husbands left them, they have no money, and they're just fending for themselves in poverty. And so we have a need to protect them as well. So there's so many ways that we can express the love of Christ to women who are suffering, and we're just trying to meet these kinds of needs in the most effective way possible.
Your last article at Charisma magazine was about women's and leadership. It is true?
Yes.
Can you present in short your point of view about these topics?
Well, I was addressing why we don't embrace women leaders oftentimes in the church. And, you know, I talked a lot about some of these scriptures that people use. Without really studying the Bible, they will throw a verse out and say, well, we can't embrace women's gifts. But I believe that if you read your Bible, you will realize that there are so many women that God used throughout Old and New Testament. And they're there for a reason. God put these women in the scripture for a reason. You know, I was just noticing that in the life of Moses, when you read in the book of Exodus, and before Moses even began his ministry, God used several women to get him to the place where he could even be used. He used the Hebrew midwives, he used Moses' mother, he used Moses' sister, he used Pharaoh's daughter. They're all in the Bible because God is using women to accomplish his purpose. So if that's true in Scripture, why don't we embrace women? What's the reason for that? Maybe we need to step back and ask ourselves that about Romania. Why are the gifts of women not embraced in Romania? Is it tradition? Is it prejudice? Do we have a bias in our hearts against women? Is it possible that some people hate women? That's one of the reasons I gave in my article, because we see this sometimes, that people actually hate women. It's evil. And there are attitudes that have to change. So my job is to help change attitudes. That's why I wrote that article. That's why I wrote my books. That's why I'm here in Romania. That's why I go around the world, is I believe that our biggest problem is up here. And the devil uses lies and strongholds and wrong patterns of thinking to keep the world in a place of bondage. But when the Holy Spirit brings truth, he sets people free from lies, and that changes nations. So I'm hoping that as I continue to come back here and as I partner with people like you and others that I've met in Romania, that we're going to see big changes here. And it's not just me. I'm encouraging others to do it. I believe you and your show, you're going to be changing a lot of attitudes too.
Thank you. We pray for that. So my prayer is like Jesus tell us to pray, Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, as in heaven, the same on the earth.
And he also prayed, deliver us from evil. And that's some of these thoughts that we have.
Yes, and I think it's a very powerful word, and it happens. We can see. Just one question about the feedbacks that you received to your books, to your articles.
Well, when you put something out there, as you know, like a TV show or a blog that goes around to many places, of course, every kind of person reads it, and people from all kinds of perspectives. And so, of course, there's going to be a lot of arguing. Sometimes there's people who stir up conflict because we allow people to comment on our articles. I don't always read all of those things because it's just sometimes it can be very negative to read all the comments every week. I don't have time to read all the comments. But I'm not disturbed by that, because I know whenever you're attempting to bring change, there's always going to be resistance. You know, in my country, there was a time when we had a lot of racism in the United States. And yet there were people who would stand up and fight that, and they would challenge racist ideas. And they would say, God created all people the same, and it doesn't matter if you're black or white or Hispanic, we're all the same. And when they would say that, they would be criticized. And of course, we have people who were even killed because they said those things. So there's always going to be a price to pay for speaking the truth. But I'm not worried, and I don't fear speaking the truth, because I believe God has empowered me to do this. And when I think about the women that I have seen around the world who suffer, women in countries like Bolivia in South America, who have been beaten by their husbands every day of their life, every day of their marriage. When I think about little girls in Uganda who have been mutilated sexually because they're 12-year-old girls. When I think about little girls in the Middle East who are forced to marry when they're 8 years old and they die on their wedding night, this is happening. When I think about women who are being trafficked and they're held as slaves, I was just in Guatemala and learned about women who are forced to be prostitutes from 8 o'clock in the morning until 1 a.m. and they have no day off. 7 days a week they have to do this. And their bodies are wasting away. This is so tragic. How can I not stand up and speak out against that? And I'm not going to worry about somebody who maybe wants to quote a scripture to contradict what I'm saying. I know Jesus cares about these people, and I'm going to fight for them, and I'm going to fight for the truth, because I know Jesus would do that.
Thank you to share us all the things from your heart, and I'm very honored to have you like a guest to my show, and I only want to say God bless you and help you to build in future His kingdom after His plans, and I hope also here in Romania we will work together for women's healing and women's releasing in God work.
And I would just like to say to you that I as I prayed for you earlier today, I saw you waving this flag in the air, and I knew that people could see it and that you were gathering people. You're not gathering people around you, but you're gathering people around the cause of Jesus Christ. And this is for a specific plan for the freedom of women in Romania. And I know that this is on the heart of God. And if the only reason why I came to Romania this trip was to encourage you about that, then it would have been worth the trip, because I know that God is in this. And I know He's going to supply for you and provide for this. And God will give you a strategy of how you can connect more and more women here in Romania, from all parts of Romania, need to come together, stop fighting about denomination or background, and come together for the cause of Christ, because He wants to release great healing to the women in this nation. And I believe God will use you to do that.
Thank you. And His will be done. And I like a lot His will. And I like also the verse from the Psalm 68, that the one word tell God, and a lot of women comes like an army. Mm-hmm. And I like to be one of His army.
Amen. You are.
Thank you. God bless you.
Bless you.
Vă mulțumim pentru răbdarea cu care ne-ați urmărit la această ediție specială a emisiunii Pentru Noi Femeile și nu rămâne de adăugat decât un singur lucru. Voia Sa să se facă și împărăția lui Dumnezeu să vină cu putere în România. Să fiți binecuvântați și să ne vedem cu bine la o nouă ediție a emisiunii Pentru Noi Femeile săptămâna viitoare. La revedere!
O emisiune sponsorizată de Matero.